Welcome back to another episode of At Home with Joslyn. I'm your hostess, Joslyn Bosoms. Tonight is a special music episode. I have interviews from two incredible musicians who have both performed at Pride of Our Footscray and both are dear friends of mine. I have the incredible Jess Porter, who zoomed in all the way from Ingerland, the land of Harry Potter and the Queen, to interview via Zoom. It was so much fun. Can't wait for you to see it. And I also have the incredible Racket. She is an amazing singer-songwriter, performer, musician, curator, artist, producer, development of entertainment. She's incredible. Stick around for that one. I also have another number or two for you. You'll have to stick around and find out if there's one or two. And I also bring to you my top three hits for Housework. And also my top three songs to get you in the mood. So let's get going to the interview, shall we? Interview this way. Hoo!
It won't be long, yeah.
Everyone, we are here with all the way from Ingerland, the amazing Jess Porter. Hey.
Hey, how are we doing?
How are you?
Yeah, good. I'm tired. It's 3 a.m.
Oh God, no wonder you look haggard, darling. I was going to say you look over 30 now.
I know. I needed to say that just to like have an excuse for why I look like this. So.
Okay. look, I'm leaving that one alone. How is it over in the great UK?
It's good. It was an interesting time to move countries.
Yeah, you picked the best time, didn't you?
Yeah, it was interesting. It was weird at first because it was like, okay, well, you know, regardless of where I am, I'm not missing anything because everyone's locked down. So okay. I was staying with my best mate. I was able to make some music and kind of do that, and that was keeping me going.
So for a bit of background, Jess is one of our amazing local artists here in Melbourne. Not Footscray, love.
because I got in trouble saying he was from Footscray. He's not from Footscray, but he's one of our regulars at Pride of Our Footscray, and he's left us to go all the way over the pond, and he actually moved right at the start of the worst part of the COVID-19 crisis. And you landed pretty much straight in the middle of restrictions, didn't you?
Yeah, I got here the day the pubs closed, so I didn't get to go to a pub in London for 3 months, I think, 3 or 4 months.
Oh, no.
So that, you know, that's the best part of the culture.
Where did you move to? Whereabouts?
So I live in Lower Clapton, which is in East London, in Hackney, which is a great area. I love it here. And I've lived here before, so this is really me moving back. And it's only for like a brief period this year. It was only going to be for 6 months.
Yeah, so really, it was like going home, wasn't it?
Yeah, to a degree. It's second home for sure.
So what is it at Ingerland that you like?
I do love Australia, but it's so far from everything. It's just this island out in, you know, like south of Asia that's just like so restricted. And, you know, I love Melbourne and Sydney, but outside of Melbourne and Sydney, there's not a lot going on. And I can say that because I'm from the country.
Yeah.
So I just like how connected everything is, especially London. London's so incredibly multicultural, incredibly like kind of switched on to what's happening in the world. You know, it's so connected literally to, you know, all the capitals of Europe. The music scene here is incredible. There's always something to discover.
Yeah.
And the boys are hot. So, you know.
Oh, fuck. I'm packing my bags. I'm coming around. Hold that.
You know, if you have my taste, which is, you know, pasty, emotionally distant men.
So you met my ex-husband then?
You were going to say that joke regardless of what I used there, but I appreciate it anyway.
Very true. Very true. So you said you're from the country. Whereabouts in the country are you from?
I'm from a small town called Goolwa on the Fluria Peninsula in South Australia.
I've heard of that place before. I actually have. I have from you, you idiot.
All right, fine. Yeah. Okay, that's fair.
So Jess and I have worked together a lot. You also played my birthday gig, which was so much fun.
Yes.
I did make you cover a song and you ended up doing it spectacularly.
Yeah, forced me to cover one of my favourite songs. It was such a chore.
Yeah, no one else in the entire bar knew what it was. And then
yeah, that's true. I don't know where the millennial gays are getting their musical influences from, but it's not Jeff Buckley.
That's so true. And I was sitting in the corner crying my eyes out. Everyone's like, why is she crying?
It's not that bad.
It's my birthday and I will fucking cry because I want to. So a little bit of background, like how long have you been performing music for? How long have you been working as a musician for?
I mean, since I was a teenager, really. I started playing in bands in high school. I guess my first serious band was when I was like 18, which was with a guy who kind of has since become my like kind of collaborative partner in many projects, including my current project. So still 15, Jesus Christ, 17 years later, we're still playing together, which is amazing. And he's the guy who I came back over here and moved in with when I got back. So that's my best mate, Cameron Sanderson,
yep.
Who's an incredible musician in his own right. Wonderful songwriter. And so we kind of part of the reason I moved back here this year was to have a reunion with our band who are called Inuit. And, finish working on a record and do a few reunion shows and kind of get the ball rolling again. Obvious reasons, that reunion show hasn't happened, so we only just started to rehearse about 6 weeks ago or something, but we finally are putting together again, which is amazing. So to be able to get in a room with the boys again and make music has just been, like, it's made this whole thing kind of feel like, okay, at least I got something out of it.
So I've seen a couple of the clips. Is it mostly... Are you doing any covers or is it all original?
Yeah, it's pretty much all original. We've done a few random covers before, but for the most part, it's original. It's largely instrumental. It's a bit different to a lot of the stuff I've done before. If anyone's seen me play solo, it's a lot of kind of singer-songwriter type, you know, folk music, pretty listenable. This band is weird. It's, you know, a lot of kind of jam stuff. We improvise a lot. I play bass in this band mostly. Cameron plays ukulele, and we have a guitarist, Sam, and a drummer, Jack. And sometimes we have this incredible violinist, Sophie, as well. And yeah, so it's like loud and weird, but it's also a lot of fun. And it's the kind of thing that, you know, people really kind of leave our shows with a smile on their faces, I think. So.
Excellent. And the band, what was the band's name again? Because you know how good I am.
Yeah, it's called Inuit, which is kind of, I guess, it's a made-up word, but it's kind of the feminized version of the word Inuit.
Make
up a word for your band name. It's very easily Googleable. It's my tip.
So talking about music, you said the singer-songwriter thing. Most of your songs are original songs, like the songs that you perform as a solo artist. They're spectacular. Do you want to talk about the writing of them and what makes you write those sorts of songs?
When I started to play solo, it kind of came off being the guitarist in a lot of bands. So feeling like I had a voice in some ways, but I wasn't telling my own stories. And so when I started writing my solo music, I wanted to make it personal. And when I'd written lyrics before for bands and usually for other singers to sing, it was a lot of cryptic stuff. It was a lot of kind of like wanky analogies and these kind of thing. And, you know, like trying to be like the musicians I listened to at the time. And when I did my first solo record, I wanted to make everything kind of as painfully clear cut as possible and be like, yep, this is what happened and this is how I feel about it. Which for me is terrifying, to have to write music and it actually reflect what happens in your life. Like, I'm sorry, that's too much for me. But when I actually push through and commit to it, I feel like it does resonate with people. I feel like a lot of my solo stuff has kind of, I don't know, lasted maybe a bit longer than a lot of the other stuff I've been part of. Like it's, you know, music that people still kind of bring up to me as being something that moved them. I haven't done a solo record in a few years. I need to get my shit together and do that. But
yeah, we do need another one. I mean, I still listen to yours all the time. So we do definitely need a new one. Yeah. You can check out Jess on Spotify as well. We will put some links up in the video as well. I've got a couple of questions. So, this one actually comes from our editor, Adrian. I do this every episode. Hi, Adrian. Adrian's filming because I don't know technology. He's hiding in the Gremlin software technical thing somehow. Hi, Adrian. He hates when I do it, but he secretly sits in his little cave going, oh, I love it. So what was your first record or CD if you're too young to know records?
Oh, my first. So I don't know if this is right. I do remember. So the first thing I got on cassette was the Grease soundtrack, which is weird because that's from the 70s, right? Grease.
Yeah.
I don't know why someone bought me the Grease soundtrack on cassette, but I do remember loving Grease as a kid.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I remember the first CD I got, I think, was Daryl Braithwaite, who I still kind of absolutely stand, to be fair.
Oh, wow.
And like more than just horses. Like Daryl Braithwaite is amazing. So
Have you ever seen Daryl Braithwaite live?
No, never. But I did have a weird kind of brush with him creatively. The first, I guess, professional CD I ever put out, record I ever put out was for my first band, Double Handed, and we got the record mastered by a great mastering engineer in Melbourne called David Briggs. And I went and watched him master it and kind of sat in on the session to get an understanding of the process. Anyway, went to his bathroom, and on his bathroom, there's a gold record, like an award for like an aria that he'd won for like best mastering engineer for a Daryl Braithwaite record. That album, it was the album that was my first album. And I was like, did you master that? And he was like, yeah. And I was like, that's the first album I ever owned, or CD I ever owned, I think it was. And, you know, it just so happened the guy I was working with on my first record mastered the fucking album that I first had. Isn't that fucking crazy?
That's nuts. That's crazy.
Yeah. So there you go.
That's cool. I've seen Daryl Braithwaite a couple of times live. He does this extended, like, 9-minute version of Horses. It's so great.
Of course he does.
It's basically, like, the same chorus, like, 45 times. But you know what? All the ladies, they love it. And the men, we all like it as well.
Yeah.
When you were growing up, whose poster did you have on your bedroom wall?
It depends on the era. So I think when I first started to get posters, it was Backstreet Boys, Spice Girls, Aqua. I loved Aqua. Yep. I still kind of love Aqua.
I love that.
Then when I turned 14, maybe, I got rid of all that and I put up Green Day and The Living End and Pennywise and all that shit. And then I got a bit more hardcore, and then it was Korn and Cold Chamber and Limp Bizkit, and I was full nu metal. And that was my shit.
Yeah.
There's something about music you listen to when you're 16, 17 that, you know, you always love it, even if it's trash. And I still listen to Slipknot and Mudvayne, and bands like the Deftones and Incubus, who I still think are great, like quite often, almost too often, as I might say. But yeah, that was my posters. It was always music. It was not, I didn't really have crush posters. I was more about like, I want to be that guy. Yeah.
What is the last song you listened to?
The last song I listened to was an Inuit song because we recorded our rehearsal the other day.
Yeah, of course it was.
And I started listening to it, but I couldn't finish because my guitar solo in it was so bad.
Speaking about metal, when I was listening to you guys rehearse, is there a little bit of a metal screamer influence in some of Inuit songs?
Yeah, it's more punk. Like, we have a lot of kind of like long proggy songs and kind of like dancey songs. And then we have a few kind of 2 or 3 minute just like punk jams where we're just all yelling, which I like because it just kind of keeps the audience, you know, on their toes.
Cool. One more question, then I'll move on to something else. What do you think is the most overrated song ever? Keeping in mind, people say Horses by Daryl Braithwaite.
Just anything by Katy Perry. I just hate Katy Perry. Sorry, gays. I can't do it. She's so insincere. I don't buy it. I just think she's a liar. Like, creatively a liar.
Okay, moving on, before we get sued. So also, you've got another project in the works as well, don't you?
Yes, I'm very proud of this.
I listened to it. I listened to the first two, and they're good.
Thank you. Thank you for listening. Great. It's not my first foray into podcasting, but the first one was a bit more of a joke. It was just me and a friend of mine talking about pop culture and getting drunk. Just kind of recording us bantering. But now the podcast is called We Don't Believe in Beatles, and it's kind of subtitled The Post Beatles Podcast. So it's about us exploring the post Beatles career of four members of the band, of which I was pretty ignorant, considering, you know, the Beatles are probably my favorite band of all time. Yeah. They are a lot of people's. I didn't really know much after it, except for kind of some of the big songs. And so my friend Jack, who I currently live with and I'm in the band with, you know, he was just like, you guys have got to listen to these records. And Cameron had the idea of like, why don't we listen to them and we'll do a podcast? So each time we listen to a record, we'll talk about it for like half an hour. And then we also had the idea of doing a cover of a song off the album at the end of each episode as well. So we talk about the album, we rate it in a stupid rating system, and then we kind of quickly bash together a cover and kind of record it live and pretty much warts and all, often in kind of like a fun, you know, reinterpretation.
It's a fun podcast, honestly. Everyone, listen to it. You can get it on Apple Podcasts. Where else can you find it?
Spotify, Anchor, Google Podcasts, Stitcher, wherever you get your podcasts, it's everywhere. Check it out. I'm really proud of it. It's something that we just threw together, and I just think it really captures our energy, me, Cameron, and Jack together. It's like if you want to listen to mates talk about music, it's kind of that vibe.
It's fun. It's informative. I didn't know a lot about the Beatles. I mean, I think it's really interesting because, you know, we grew up hearing the Beatles music and listening to it, and even now they're getting a resurgence. So I think it's a great podcast. Do yourself a favor. Oh God, I just Molly Meldrumed. Go out there and pick up. I cannot believe I just did that. He's one of my heroes.
Well, that's deep into your subconscious. You have to let it out.
It really is. That's why I don't wear cowboy hats, and I don't wear hats in general, except for wigs. So honestly, go out and listen to it. It's really, really fun. It's really enjoyable. One more question. This is a question I ask everybody. Who could you, if you could have a meal with anyone living or dead, who would it be?
Joe Jackson. No question.
Who, sorry?
Joe Jackson. He's my favorite musician. He wrote the song, Is She Really Going Out With Him? That's what everyone knows him for. But yeah, he's also had an incredibly long and prestigious career, and he's just fascinating. And I think he's probably a jerk, but I really need to find out. Like, I would love to pick his brain about music for, you know, an hour or 2 hours. So it'd be Joe Jackson.
Thank you so much for joining us, Jess. I know it's really, really late where you are, so I really do appreciate that. Do you have anything you want to plug? Where can we find your music, your band's name, all that sort of stuff?
Sure. So Inuit have 5 albums available on Spotify and everywhere. The last one is the best one. And we're also doing like a live in studio concert soon. So basically, because we couldn't do a reunion show, we're getting a bunch of cameras, we're getting a recorder, and we're doing like a live studio kind of show. And it's going to be weird. It's going to be fun. It's going to be in the spirit of us, probably involve costumes and silliness. And that will be online sometime in the next few months. I'm not really sure when. Besides that, you can check out We Don't Believe in Beatles everywhere you get podcasts. And follow me on Twitter at Jess Portasolo. That's it.
Excellent.
And it's so nice to talk to you, Joss. I miss you heaps.
Oh, doll, I miss you heaps. It's Friday nights aren't the same without you hanging around in your gaudy sequin jacket.
I have one of them over on my clothes.
Or walking around my dressing room without a shirt on. How dare you tease a girl like that?
How dare you reveal my secrets?
Secrets, darling. Footscray seeing you topless for nearly a year. We miss you. Have a wonderful time in the merry old land of England.
Thank you, darling. Take care.
Bye.
I call it housework. Light work, what you gonna do? But I'ma throw shade if I don't get paid for this housework. She was high.
Hello, Pride of Footscray, Joslyn Bosoms, and everyone in Melbourne and around the world listening to us right now.
We miss you. You were last performing at Pride of Our Footscray in February, is that right?
Yes. Did I do a double? Did I do it twice?
No, yeah, you did it twice for one of the festivals, and then you did my birthday show, which was amazing.
Yeah.
And we actually filmed the Oxytoxic film clip the next day.
Oh, yeah, yes. Oh, my God. So much fun.
So, Oxytoxic, a bit of background for everyone. Racket is an amazing singer-songwriter, performer, musician, just incredible performer. I love you so much. your music has evolved so much over the years. Do you want to quickly talk about that?
Yeah, well, I guess for me, like, I played punk rock. I was the front woman of a punk rock band for 4 years, and then towards the end of the 4 years, I was like starting to listen to a lot of Charlie XCX, a lot of Dorian Electra, Manu Blue, Mood Killer, and I just kind of like, I was kind of keeping it secret because like everyone had this expectation of me to be like rock and roll chick, and I kind of just came out and was like, actually, like, I think the punkest thing right now is pop. So I came out and as a pop artist, which is really weird for like a punk rock artist to go to pop. And, you know, there were some challenges along the way. I think the biggest challenge was finding venues that support pop music in Australia that aren't necessarily on a theatre level, like at a ground level. And that's how I got connected with you and the community of Pride of Footscray, because you guys actually had me. Like you welcomed me with open arms. You showed me a glimpse into the possibilities of the LGBTQI community and just welcomed me and was open to my weirdness and my queerness. And, you know, it was just like I found my family, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, so I was in your film clip for Oxytoxic, which, by the way, banger of a song. I absolutely love that song so much. That film clip was so much fun to be in. You got, how many drag performers did you end up getting in the clip? There was quite a few.
Yeah, well, I had 8 and they were all, you know, local Melbourne talent. Yep. Yourself, Bay Lamar, Cerithium, Crayola, Alpha, Alfalfa, so many. I can't remember all of them off the top of my head. Yeah, it was a beautiful cast and such a generous opportunity to be allowed into, you know, the Pride of Our Footscray venue during the day. And just like, yeah, I just probably never met a community that's more supportive than you guys.
And you've got a new single out, which is, once again, a absolute banger. Do you want to talk about Crush?
Yeah, so Crush was kind of like an extension of Oxytoxic. So when you and I did the film clip, it was like freestyle dancing, total self-expression. And then for Crush, I came back to Sydney, recruited 20 dancers, built a giant neon installation, and just worked with choreographers and created this gorgeous film clip once again. And Crush is like super, super sweet. It's like, I'm just obsessed with it.
It's so beautiful. It's so cool. I mean, because we've all had crushes and it's perfect. I mean, I've got a music crush on you, let's be honest.
Oh, thank you.
You know, we are. Now, you created that film clip yourself. You did that art installation. You assist with the designing of your costumes, the choreography. You have such a heavy hand in everything, including the editing. So why do you decide to do that? Why don't you let other people help?
It's lack of budget, baby.
Yeah. Well, no, I agree, but I think it's also your vision of everything is great. If you've ever seen a racket show, there's lights, there's everything. No two racket shows are the same. You did a very condensed version of a racket show for my birthday show. And we will be putting a photo up here. You can see how much you give into your performance because you were makeup dripping everywhere, but you were so much fun and we love having you on that stage.
Thank you. I absolutely love being on your stage. Like I said,
we can't wait till we go back.
Me too.
What was the first concert you ever went to?
The first concert I ever went to was with my dad to see Red Hot Chili Peppers.
Nice, cool.
Yeah.
And did they love your music to start with?
Definitely like a big influence when I started doing, you know, rock and punk and garage. And I still love them, absolutely. But I was, listening to a lot of them, a lot of The Kills, Smashing Pumpkins, and obviously like The Cranberries is like, you know, like a staple, staple influence for me.
What is your ultimate guilty pleasure song?
Oh, probably Tina Turner, Simply the Best.
Ah, yeah.
Like, okay. I never get old of that song. Like, I can always put it on. But there's one more that's, like, slightly more, like, off the grid. I don't know if you guys remember Coco Jumbo by Mr. President.
Yes! I saw Mr. President last year in Melbourne.
No way. Are you serious?
Yes.
Dude, what the hell?
Yes, they were amazing. Coco Jumbo is such a good jam. I might even do
Hold on. I need to back this up one sec. You saw Mr. President last year.
I'm sure I did. Hang on. Were they part of the So Pop concert that I saw last year?
Actually, you know what? I think it was. And there was what? Who else was there? Banger Boy.
Aqua and Bewitched. I went to see Bewitched because, you know, I love me a bit of a girl group. And they were part of it because they did like 9.5 minutes of Coco Jumbo.
No way. Are you serious?
I've got the footage. I will send the footage to you. I'm sure. Look, I'm probably deluded. Oh, hang on. Adrian's saying it was last year in February. Yes, I did see them. Nice. It was such a good concert.
I gotta go, go, Coco. Put me up, put me down. Put my feet back on the ground. Put me up, take my heart and make me happy.
Oh, bow, bow. Oh God, that was good. Okay, so you can see how amazing your voice is. Everyone needs to follow and listen to you because your voice is spectacular. A last question before we head off, because I know you've got to go. What is one song that you would absolutely love to cover?
Oh, okay. Well, I have been thinking about this recently. And do you remember that song, Damn, I Wish I Was Your Lover?
Oh,
the daylight comes, wait till you are smiling and warm. I am everything, tonight I'll be your mama.
I love that song. Okay, you need to cover that.
Just to sing that one word.
Damn. Of course I know that song. It was used in Dawson's Creek.
Oh, my God. Yes. I forgot about that.
Oh, hang on. I have just been reminded by our editor. Hello, Adrian, who is Zooming recording from a secret location, a.k.a. his office. I forgot to ask our last question, which is the one I ask everyone. Would you like to have dinner with, dead or alive, and why?
I would love to have dinner with Charlie XCX so that I can charm her into doing a track with me.
I don't think that would be very hard. All she needs to do is listen to your music, Tal.
I'll give it a Bundy charm, you know?
Thank you so much for joining us. It's been a pleasure. I know it was a really quick one, but I miss you so much and I can't wait to see you and dance with you again.
You too. I love you so much, Joslyn. Thank you.
Thank you. Honestly. Very quickly, what can people find you doing at the moment in isolation? Give us a bit of a plug for all of your amazing things you're doing because you've got so much you're doing.
Yeah. Okay, well, first thing I'm doing is I produce a show with Heaps Gay and it's aired on Mardi Gras. It's called Loud and Queer TV and it's performance art and queer artists performing live in the studio. So that's one thing. Go and check that out on Heaps Gay. I produce that. Sorry, darling?
Everyone, go watch it. It's so much fun. I've tuned in so many times. The karaoke sessions are sick.
So funny.
Yeah.
And the second thing I do is take a lot of photos of myself and I would highly suggest that you do it. Actually, like, I'm not even kidding because, I just have felt in myself like a huge increase in confidence and like my self-worth. Even just like, I know it sounds very vain, but, you know, if you just when I take photos of myself, the more I've been independently doing it instead of relying on photographers and just being like, oh yeah, like I look good here, I look good there, I look good here. Like I just feel like it's a very like therapeutic exercise to appreciate yourself.
Yeah.
That's the second thing I'm doing. The third thing I'm doing is gearing up for another release. So by the time this airs, I should have announced a new single, filming a new video clip and just committed to bringing you guys new music every 6 weeks. That's my...
Excellent. Make sure you follow Racket on Spotify. You can listen to you on Spotify. Buy your album, support you, Instagram, all that stuff. We'll have some links everywhere. Darlin, thank you so much for joining me.
I love you guys so much. Can't wait to see you again.
Bye.
See you, Darlin. Like you
lied about it. I lied about it. I tried to doubt this could be real. You've touched me far too much. I'm letting go of all the pain. I'm into you.
Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this episode, our special music episode of At Home with Joslyn. I hope you had as much fun watching as I had filming and interviewing our guests, performing numbers and doing all the silly stuff that I like to do to entertain you all. Thanks again for watching. I hope to see you next week where I bring you another lot of two interviews. That's right, I have two interviews again next week, plus numbers, plus fun. I'll see you next week. Stay safe, stay happy, lots of love. Oh, do like this wig style, actually. Bye. A deep love.